This truck here is the medial articular part, and then it articulates with the trochlear notch of the ulna. Now, we have the medial part of the trochlea and the lateral part of the trochlea. The medial part of the trochlea actually extends a little lower than the lateral part of the trochlea, with about 6 millimeters. So what this does is to actually create the angle that's called the carrying angle that enables the arm and forearm to swing clear of the trunk. Now, it's also lined by hyaline cartilage. Now, on the lateral part, we see the rounded second articular part of the condylar part. Now, this part is the part that relates with the radius. It relates with the head of the radius. Now, the running medially, we see the area of the radius called the medial epicondyle. It's that prominent towards the right. And then what it does, it gives surface for attachment of muscles. And then we also have already looked at the lateral epicondyle and then the supracondylar ridges. Now, above, we see the dotted lines here. These dotted lines here actually give us the area for attachment of the capsular ligament, which is the ligament of the elbow joint. So the next thing I'm going to quickly do is to look at the muscle attachment. The muscle attachment of these muscles also makes it very interesting. And we're going to start from the proximal. So we'll start with the muscle attachment. We'll start with both the muscle attachment and then we'll try to identify some of the ligaments, particularly the capsular ligaments. So we'll start with the anatomical neck. We noted that in the anatomical neck, gives room for attachment of the glenohumeral ligament. So this point, this marks the point of attachment, the capsular ligament of the shoulder joint, which is the glenohumeral ligament. That's the point of attachment. Now the next muscle we look at here, we look at the bicipital, the lesser tubercle. The lesser tubercle gives an insertion to subscapularis. So we see subscapularis, we see the subscapularis giving insertion at this point. Now we look at, we peep from the posterior side, we look at we see the infraspinatus, and then we also see the teres minor. Now this is capsular ligament. This is the subscapularis, and this is the supraspinatus. Now when we also look at the floor, we see the area for insertion. These are all insertions. We see the area for insertion of latissimus dorsi. Now when we go to the anterior border, as it runs anterior border down, we see a rough part of the anterior border which is the area for insertion of the coracobrachialis. Now, just as you noted, this is the point of deltoid tuberosity. We also see the point for insertion of the deltoid muscle. Now, by the time we move distally, if you can notice some interesting things happening here, most of the muscle attachments in this anterior surface, in the brachial part, are actually insertions. Insertion of subscapularis, insertion of supraspinatus, insertion of infrasinatus, insertion of teres minor, insertion of latissimus dorsi, insertion of coracobrachialis, insertion of deltoid. But as we move down, we notice in the both anteromedial surface and anterolateral surface, we see the origin of brachialis muscle. So we see in this lower half, we see the origin of the brachialis muscle. That's the brachialis. Now, by the time we move distally towards the distal part, on the medial side, on the proximal one third, we see another muscle origin. This will be the muscle origin for the pronator teres. Now, on the same side, laterally, on the upper to third, we see the origin for brachioradialis. Now, if we move a little down, we see that for ascensor carpi radialis longus, and then when we come down, that's upper to third, middle third. Now when we come down to the lateral epicondyle, we see just as what we have at this point too. This is the medial epicondyle, anterior surface of the medial epicondyle, and anterior surface of the lateral epicondyle. For the medial epicondyle, we see what we call the common flexor origin. This is the common flexor origin, FM. Now this is on the lateral epicondyle, we have the common extensor origin. So we have a number of muscles that are found here, ranging from the flexor carpi radialis longus to flexor pterygium superficialis and all the palmaris longus, all the flexor muscles in the forearm. They have five of the superficial flexors have their origin at this common flexor origin, and then we also have all the muscles in the extensor compartment of the forearm. They also have their origin apart from the arch propri muscles, and then the brachioradialis and the carpiradialis longus. The others, the extensor pterygium superficialis, and all the rest have their origin from this lateral epicondyle. Also, lateral epicondyle on the posterior surface, as you can see here, lateral epicondyle on the posterior surface also gives origin to another muscle. The name of that muscle is Anconius. The name of the muscle is Anconius. Now, if we can notice that, as we move proximally, we see most of the muscle attachments are insertions. And then as we come this time, most of the muscle attachments are origin. Now, we also noted some things that we need, that's what passing the information. At this point, at the point of the anteromedial surface, more towards the medial border, we see the nutrient foramen, for the humerus, which is at this point, the nutrient foramen. Now let's have a look at what is happening at the posterior surface. Remember, this is the posterior surface. Now, at the posterior surface, although in the shaft, when we look at the shaft, we have this groove called the radial groove. Now, above the radial groove, that's the groove running from, running this way. Now, in this groove, this is the radial groove. Now, above the radial groove, we have an oblique ridge. Now, in this ridge, we find the triceps muscles giving their origin. Now, at this point, we see the point of origin of the lateral head of triceps brachii muscle. So this is, we see the lateral head of triceps brachii muscle, The triceps has three heads. The first head, that's the long head, has already taken origin from the scapula, as the infraglenoid tubercle of the scapula. So we're going to see the rest of the other heads of triceps taking origin from the posterior surface of the humerus. So we already noted the point of origin of the lateral head. The remaining head of the triceps, which is the medial head, will run from below the radial groove. Up to this point. Run on this surface. That is the radial groove. So this is the medial head. Of the triceps brachii. So when we look at all these muscle attachments, we see the various areas of origins and then insertions of the muscles that are either inserting or taking origin on the humerus. Now the next thing we look at will be the clinical anatomy of the humerus. But before we look at the clinical anatomy of the humerus, the next question will be, how does one know the right humerus from the left humerus? Now, let's start from the head. The head of the humerus faces medially, as it's facing. The head moves tilted upwards and then backwards. So the head of the humerus faces what I call mob. This is mob. The head of the humerus faces mob, which is medially upwards and backwards. Now the same thing also is seen in the direction of the medial epicondyle of the humerus, because the medial epicondyle also faces medially upwards and backwards. That's the direction of the head of the humerus. And then also notice that when the anterior surface of the humerus has these two fossa, and they are the coronal fossa and the radial fossa, with the trochlear not facing medially. And then on the posterior aspect, we see the olecranon fossa at this point. So the anatomical position of the humerus is that the head of the humerus must face medially, and then the olecranon fossa must face posteriorly. So by the time the olecranon fossa is facing posteriorly and the head of the humerus facing medially, you will see that both the coronoid and the radial fossa will also be seen anteriorly. That will help you to determine whether the humeral bone of the body is right or left. Now, let us look at the clinical anatomy. Now, we'll first of all look at some variations. So we notice that between the coronoid fossa on the posterior aspect and the coronoid fossa on the posterior aspect and then the coronary force of the arterial stent. There is a thin plate of bone separating both fossa. But there are situations where this thin plate of bone, called the supratrochlear plate, there are situations where this thin plate of bone are no longer there. And then when such happens, we see a foramen like the one we are seeing here. We see an opening that will now connect the coronary fossa anteriorly to the holocoronary fossa posteriorly. So such fossa, we call that fossa supratrochlear foramen. We call such fossa supratrochlear foramen. So that is what we are having here. That's what is seen. That's the variation that is seen here. Also, we also notice that there are some other variations where we notice that as part of the supracondylar ridge, remember this is a supracondylar ridge. So ordinarily we now have this process coming from the supracondylar ridge. And now the condition where we now have a bony projection running from the supracondylar ridge running distally is a variation. Usually when these variations happen, we also see some ligamentous attachment running from the middle epicondyle connecting to that process. So the name of that process running downward is called the supratrochlear process. It's called the supratrochlear process. And the man that discovered this ligament is Strutter. So this ligament has been named after him, and the ligament is called the Strutter's ligament. When this variation occurs, we notice the direction of movement of both the brachial artery and then the median nerve as they run to the forearm. We notice as a change. Usually they pass through this space created by both the supratrochlear process and then the Strutter's ligament. Now we notice some things about the humerus. We notice three nerves that run close to the humerus and the areas they run close to the humerus. Now we notice at the level of the surgical neck, that is the level we have here, at the level of the surgical neck, we notice the axillary nerve, running round the shaft, around the level of the surgical neck. So at this point, this nerve, that's the axillary nerve here. So when we have fracture at this level of the humerus, these structures that we find here will also be very susceptible to damage. So the structures here around this fracture could be damaged. Now the next area, we have some nerves and other structures running close to the bone, is along the area of the radial groove. Remember the radial groove that we noted here? It's at this point. So we see the nerve here. The nerve we find running close to the radial groove is the radial nerve. So the radial nerve runs along the radial groove alongside with the profunda brachial artery. So that's the radial nerve and that's the radial groove. So at this point, if there's a fracture at this level of the shaft, these structures lying very close to this area of fracture will be susceptible to damage. The next very important area where we also see nerves running very close to the bone is at the level of the medial epicondyle. Now, deep in the medial epicondyle, we see the ulnar nerve running below the medial epicondyle. Running below the medial epicondyle. That's the ulnar nerve. So when there's a fracture at this level, it can also affect the ulnar nerve. So when we look at it, also we have, soon we talk about the fractures, we have what we call the supracondylar fracture. That's a fracture that happens around here. And sometimes we also see median nerve running across here. So when we have that area, we also have median nerve at this point. So when we bring all these nerves together, when we bring those muscles, we see median nerve running here. So we have these areas of fracture. Well, these are the nerves. When we look at the humerus, we've outlined three major points where nerves run close to the bone. First point is at the surgical neck. Second point is at the radial groove. Third point is behind the medial epicondyle. Now I want to also bring some points of fracture. Now we see some areas of fracture of this bone are one at the level of the surgical neck. The next point is at the level of the radial groove. We also have at the level above the condylar part of the bone, which is called the supracondylar region, which is called the supracondylar fracture. Now, at the point of the supracondylar fracture, the nerve that is closest here is the median nerve. So, if we bring these nerves together, the three nerves that can lie vulnerable to these three major points of fracture are one, number one is the axillary nerve, number two is the radial nerve, number three is the median nerve. They will give us a simple mnemonic called AL. We also actually told you that the ulnar nerve lies deep in the medial epicondyle. And then, if there's a fracture, they can also affect the ulnar nerve. So if you can recall all, you can also call it AM-OR. 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 Which is axillary nerve, radial nerve, median nerve, and then ulnar nerve. Now, when we also look at this supracondylar fracture, the next diagram we have here actually shows us what happens during this supracondylar fracture. Usually, when we have supracondylar fracture, what usually happens is that the distal end will move backwards. When it moves backwards, it creates an enlargement around the elbow joint. And then sometimes this could be mistaken for dislocation of the elbow joint. But how to separate that is we have the three points of the elbow joint. We have one is the medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle, and then the olecranon process of the ulna. So usually when we have supracondylar fracture, what we see those aligning of the three points of the elbow joint. Another important point to note about the clinical anatomy of the humerus is the area of vascularization. We notice that the junction between the middle third and the distal third of the humerus is poorly vascularized. And usually when we have fractures at that point, it is usually very difficult to heal. Also, going by the muscles we see around the shoulder, around the head of the humerus, these muscles, as you can see them, the subscapularis, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor. These muscles form what we call the rotator cuff muscles. So what they do is that they come together and form a cuff above the head of the humerus. This humerus actually is most easily dislocated inferiorly. The next thing we look at before we round up the class is ossification. The bone has one set of ossification at the shaft and and 7 other secondary education centers. In the special centers, we have 3 centers at the Brooklyn part and then the 4 centers at the Distant part. Thank you very much.